You cannot have innovation without pain. Web 2.0 is broken. We see censorship, we see overregulation, we see citizen surveillance, and there were extremely nasty things. Isn't that like fundamentally wrong? So what free Web 3.0 has to offer? Hi, everybody. In a positive way, surprised to see so many people participating in the conference. And today, a short presentation on the state, current state, and the future of decentralized apps and decentralized organizations. The previous speaker gave a pretty good overview of the evolution of the web. I will just repeat very, very briefly, what do we mean by saying Web 3.0 or Web 3, because that's the name of the conference. So it all started with Web 1.0. And still I hear a lot of opinions that that actually was the only truly open web. Yes, static, yes, primitive, text only, super slow, but it was pretty much open. It was driven initially by primarily science and academics. The next chapter is Web 2.0, is where we live today. So it's interactive, it's not only reading the news or the information, it's about sharing, it's about content creation, it's about bringing the crowd or the people into building content. That's a huge difference. So as opposed to the dominant model of some media outlets or some corporations or some governments just pushing the news the way they are, the paradigm shift was, it is now the user who is creating the web. And I really liked one statement about Twitter maybe 10 years ago, saying, you know what? Twitter is powerful because every single user is a filter and multiplier of information coming through. So as opposed to just one newspaper saying that is the news and that is supposed to be read and stated that way, we have millions of people at will evaluating, sharing, multiplying, or filtering off or commenting. So we have a network of people doing this stuff. Now the by effect, good or bad, is that the Web 2.0 is driven by the big tech, right? The Googles, the Apples of the world, it has pluses, it has minuses. I will comment on that a little later in the presentation. But we're here to talk about Web 3.0. And that's a new paradigm shift. It's starting in like 21 plus, and it is expected that 3.0 will be driven by decentralized apps and decentralized organizations. And I will slightly touch on that later. Now, before we go to Web 3.0, I want to come back to Web 1.0. I liked another statement on the internet, which stated, if the governments knew what the internet really is, none would allow it to exist at all, period. I think there is a lot of truth to that, because if you really think what was happening at the very, very beginning of a deregulated internet, basically all the regulations were broken. We're talking about gambling, sales, news, censorship, license activities, finances, everything was kind of against the law. And for 10 maybe years, the government simply like had no idea how to deal with that, like no idea. And that's probably the one kind of way to allow actually for innovation to come forward, is because there is a window of opportunity, I call it a window of opportunity for technology, because for a certain period of time, like nobody really knows what's happening. So it is a Wild West period. Yes, it comes with a price. Just as the Web 3.0 has a lot of victims today, scams and forgotten passwords and inefficient technology and all this stuff. But that's inevitable price. You cannot have innovation without pain. It is untrue to say that innovation is only a good thing. In short term, innovation always is a pain. So you have to experience that. So just for now, I would just kind of send that message that Web 1.0 was Wild West, came with primitive tools, but came in a deregulated way, and it regulated itself and kind of like evolved. Luckily, before governments realized what's going on, so by the time regulations came in, you already had YouTube, Facebook, and all the other benefits, again, which were really against the regulations at the time they started. Now I hear for the last maybe 5-10 years that Web 2.0 is broken in many, 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 many ways. Yes, it comes with nice technology, interactive, multi-three-dimensional, whatever, images and so on, the community, so a lot of good things, but it is fundamentally broken in many, many, many ways. I'll try to like identify just 3 major ways. So one is, as often, not always, but often, it's the governments trying to do good things, or at least saying or pretending. By the way, just I ask that question pretty often, is how many of you actually read the cookie wall agreements? One? Just one. So how many of you actually click yes? Nearly 100%. Like, isn't that like fundamentally wrong? Like 100% click yes, I agree to send my mother to hell. And only one buffers to read. You, the one reading the agreement, do you understand what's written in those like technical legal jargon? Do you understand what you read?
I'm a lawyer.
You are a lawyer. have you actually written this text? Okay, now it makes sense. So isn't that like kind of crazy? The only person who has read the agreement is the one writing that agreement. I mean, don't you find this stupid? I mean, I personally found it like totally stupid, like totally stupid. Like demanding a that long agreement for reading a news site, it's like demanding an agreement for just crossing the street. Like imagine street light, green light. Before you proceed coming to that street, you have to agree to that lawyer agreement, blah, 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 because you agree that you could be hit by the truck. Stupido, sorry, but stupido. And the worst part that it's actually theoretically is done by trying the governments to impose a good thing, protect the user. So the actual flag is pretty good. Anyway, so under this protection word, we see censorship, we see overregulation, we see citizen surveillance, and there were extremely nasty things happening under the protect the user flag. So frankly, when it comes to government, I found it difficult to always trust the results of the intent. Just some facts. So luckily, we live in a relatively democratic part of the world, but in 2022, Russia has blocked 300,000 websites. Just 1 year, 300,000. That's approximately the amount that China blocked during the same period. So again, always for the good of a consumer. The second is big tech. So again, luckily, most of the big tech is concentrated in the relatively developed democratic part of the world. But there is more and more voices saying that, sorry guys, king is dead, long live the king. How many of you actually are following Fortnite versus Apple and Google? Just a couple. Okay, just to remind you that Google and Apple seamlessly, very slowly, kind of became gatekeepers for all the mobile app world. You cannot publish the app. You cannot give the app to the consumer unless Google and Apple say, yes, I approve that. Unless they have a cut. And that's precisely what Fortnite, the biggest game on the planet, versus Apple and Google is. They say, just because you exist in my mobile phone, you have to pay me 30% cut on whatever money you make, just because I allow you to exist. I do believe in freedom of speech. I don't know how many of you followed the Telegram versus Google story on the Israeli news a couple weeks ago. So Telegram, to me, it's one of the players that actually do propagate the unconditional free speech, got into trouble with Google because they're saying, well, you know, we pushed by the government for you to close some of the Palestinian channels that you have in Telegram. And Telegram said, well, I believe in free speech. That's what the founder said. So I will not close any channels because freedom is unconditional. And Google said, well, fine. In that case, we'll throw your Telegram out of Android, period. So with that threat, Telegram said, well, I do prefer to be on the Android rather than closed, so I have to comply. So there's more and more voice saying that it's wrong, that the control has shifted from governments to big tech, and that we are deciding at will, like whatever moral or business or whatever principles we're using, whom to allow to exist, how to charge, and so on and so on and so on. Finally, data privacy and safety. Finally. It is a myth, total myth, that the consumer is protected, either by the government, GDPR, cookie rules, whatever, or the big tech. Total myth. How many of you, just for research or self-education purposes, have just bothered to Google on the dark net if you have been leaked in any of the databases? One person? Three persons. Just do it for fun, because you will find that all the Facebook databases, all the hundreds of million users, all the databases you could possibly think of have been leaked on the darknet, easily available for you for $10. $15, I think. $20, okay. So just do it for fun. Just to discover that all the protections and GDPRs and all these regulations and all this like big tech protection, it's a bullshit. It doesn't exist. You've been leaked, and if I really want, I could find like any single person in Lithuania, personal identity number, first last name, last password, and so on and so on. So easy that it just bothers me. So. Whatever we call protection in reality doesn't exist. And inherently, the weakest point is not technology. It is, coming back, human factor. Human factor. Nobody can protect, nobody, of bad employee leaving the company with a bad taste because he's been fired and taking away database. Doesn't matter how many encryption keys you have. Just doesn't matter. And that's been the case in Lithuania. I do not want to mention the company, but that's exactly been the case in Lithuania, where they just leak it to the world and say, well, that's what I want to do, because nobody can protect against humans. So these are, again, these are three, probably three main ones, but there's a lot of things that are broken, totally broken about Web 2.0. So what free Web 3.0 has to offer? And these are the four fundamental principles that are very different from Web 2.0 or 1.0. One, the whole infrastructure is totally decentralized. There is no Google Cloud or Amazon Cloud or server or database, not a one physical or legal location that you can just shut down or destroy or influence otherwise. So just as torrents and Bitcoin has proven in the last decades, for now, decentralized infrastructure actually is resistant to physical, legal, political, other threats. So for now, yes, it could power the new paradigm. Second, it's community-driven. Legally, that's a wonderful thing, wonderful thing. I was having a conversation with a local financial regulator, because due to my activity, I do have to have those talks regularly. And I was saying, look, we're having like a 6-month debate over allowing one checkbox in that application, and here is like a DeFi application that anybody can download, like anybody. And it goes like every single regulation that you're trying to impose on me. So how can I possibly compete for a better user experience, if you're allowing me to do that, and I like can download in 30 seconds yet, so at least like block those, because we're not in the same playing field. This is just unfair competition. Response was, We tried to identify their legal address and couldn't. And that's it. If you can't find the legal address, you can't send letter, you can't send like cops or whatever, you can't possibly influence. So the preferred scenario then just like ignore. And that's exactly what the governments have now chosen their position to. If I can't control, if it doesn't fit the existing legal framework, we just leave it alone. Let it develop, whatever, we don't care. So the community-driven projects, just as Bitcoin or Ethereum, where you have like a million owners and no owner, just as torrent network, just as Bitcoin network, just as Ethereum network, for now, it's resistant, again, to physical threat, to political threat, to big tech, et cetera, et cetera. So that's a huge thing. Now, the third thing is autonomous. How many of you actually have heard of autonomous organizations, total autonomous? Maybe 20%. Okay, so it's a new wonderful phenomena where a company or infrastructure or service is run by the machines, automatic code, zero people, like zero. And that's, again, a wonderful thing because if you have like a 100% automatic protocol, it's written in the code, it's transparent for everybody, everybody can see what's going on if they want to check the source code, it just operates. Unshuttable, unstoppable, there are like no CEO, no CTO, no technical engineer to support, just automatically operates. Again, for now, it's resistible, physically, politically, economically, legally, et cetera, et cetera. You cannot yet sue a computer or put a computer to prison. You cannot yet like send cease and desist letter to a like, distributed application and say, well, stop to exist. For now, it's just not going on. And the fourth part, which I like personally the most, that kind of paradigm, distributed, decentralized, autonomous, run by the community, is extremely well positioned to take advantage of the AI opportunities that are coming. How many of you have heard of the WorldCoin initiative? Okay, 20%. So for the rest of you, it's a great initiative by the founder of ChatGPT, by the way, who is saying, look, 20 years from now, or maybe 50, doesn't really matter, economy will exist without people. Because computers and AI will have everything they need to produce whatever necessary amount of energy, of services, of goods. So basically supply everything a human needs totally autonomously, without a human. And now, in preparation for this world, maybe we need some protocol to distribute that wealth or that good created by the AI evenly. So it doesn't get concentrated in governments or big tech or billionaires or oligarchs or whatever it is. So that's the WorldCoin initiative. Every single human could scan their eye because scanning the eyes gives you like a sort of identity in that world. And we will distribute income, whatever is generated by AI, evenly to everybody. That's it. So in the ideal, totally ideal world, AI will create the good and will basically distribute that good evenly to every single address, and again, address being the iris scan, so it's a unique human. That's it. Again, no governments, no legal, no tech, just products and services directed to people. So again, theoretically, the idea is great. It's positioned very well. It couldn't possibly exist in the current legal framework, period. Just would never, ever, ever, ever be allowed. By the way, coincidentally or not, but it's currently serving people except in the US. Because US is well known for being a little bit more advanced than other countries on regulating and controlling the DeFi and all those parts. Anyway, these are the principles of the Web 3.0. Again, I personally do believe that just as in 1.0 era, it will, yes, lead to the Wild West period, where on the one hand, lack of regulation means you have to be extremely careful what you do. On the other hand, now we do live in the better version of 1.0, So the self-regulation and lack of government control and then basically market economy made it really better. That's my true belief. So I hope that exactly same happens to Frida though. So that's pretty much it. And you can download the presentation on LinkedIn, more presentations on YouTube. So for now, as I understand, a couple of questions, yes?
Yeah, thank you, Ilya.
Thank you.
Terrific. Terrific, yeah. Indeed, there are some questions on this Slido, which I haven't checked yet, but I have one philosophical question, because this is really very deep things which you have touched upon, and actually, you know, Web 1, Web 2, it was the internet, the early internet was like a promised land for everyone. It has a very beautiful promise of liberty.
Had
liberty, freedom, no control, no censorship. But we, people, have ruined it. We have spoiled it. Our nature has spoiled it. Regulation, governments.
Some of us.
Big techs. And now it's controlled our... Well, who knows that our e-life is basically controlled and our social lives on social networks are being controlled by just a couple of algorithms. Okay, four or five algorithms. No one knows who is behind them. Ilya has touched upon that, right? No one... Well, everyone more or less assumes that this is okay, but this is not okay. We are living in the bubbles. The more we live in the bubbles, the worse society we are. And Web3 has also this potential and for better society, right? But don't you think that inherently our human nature will spoil this as well?
Totally the opposite. Again, to me, if history has shown anything at all, that the core human virtues and values, like core, where the good is dominant over the bad, ultimately win, ultimately. Mm-hmm. The history has shown in the physical world, in the industrial world, in the computer world, so just as Web 1.0, non-regulated way evolved into something better, or of course, we've seen like a lot of other things, so inherently I believe that the hard-coded into our human DNA virtues will ultimately win. So just leave it as is, let it self-regulate, let it evolve, and then it will be a better version of what we have now. That's my honest true belief.
I hope so as well, but I saw the singularity. One of the four key principles, autonomous, decentralized, community, singularity. Do you believe humans in the long run will have place in AI-driven world?
I will reformulate.
No, but do you believe human beings will have a place?
Human will always can be human. And I believe in liberation.
Okay.
Statistics, facts. 70% of employees, both in Europe and the US, don't like their job. So spending further their lives on something you have to do and you don't like just because you have to pay your bills, to buy food, etc., wrong. It's totally wrong. A human is not created to just suffer forever, and technology will liberate. Yes, a lot of people will choose a couch potato life. Free couch, free apartment, free whatever next iPhone or virtual reality set is, I choose to watch football. Minority will use that spare time to actually build something that they really want, with social enterprises or like sports achievements or something else. So I do believe that if you take off that economical drag of having to do what you don't like and don't want just because you need to eat, we'll live to a better life. That's my honest belief.
Yeah. So, well, this is a promise. This is hope. Thank you, Ilya, once again.
Thank you.